All right, three Filipino soldiers hurt in China's latest water cannon attack against the Philippines. Beijing there seemingly undeterred by President Ferdinand Marcos Jr.'s efforts to rally international support for the Philippines. At this point, what else can the Philippines do to counter China's growing aggression in the South China Sea?
Well, the course is pretty clear for us. We have to persist. We have to continue. And by doing that, we will also continue to rally international support to our side. No? China's claims are clearly baseless and illegal. Anyone looking at the map will immediately question China's excessive claim to water so close to the Philippines. So I think we just need to keep on persisting and enduring, no, with resolve and commitment on this. That's really the only path for us. Otherwise, if we surrender, then we surrender these waters forever, essentially. And China will gain quite a lot more than just waters of the Philippines. It will essentially gain the entire South China Sea.
Right. Analysts and other countries have praised the Philippines' public relations efforts when it comes to publicizing China's attacks against the Philippines. But at this point, how wise would it be for the government to actually heed the call of certain camps to allow civilian vessels to join RORA missions or other similar efforts in the West Philippine Sea?
Well, for me personally, I'm not yet on that, I've not yet reached that point where I would advocate purely civilian vessels. As it is, we are using civilian vessels in the resupply missions. These are chartered by the Armed Forces of the Philippines, and they were intended to show that what we're doing there is not provocative, but clearly China does not care about the character of these vessels. The other problem with using purely civilian vessels, of course, is that civilian vessels will be subject to the jurisdiction of foreign law enforcement and military vessels. No, there's a rule in international law that they can undertake boarding and inspection measures against purely civilian vessels. And so that might actually interfere even more or give the Chinese even more ground to interfere with civilian resupply activities. However, this is something that I think should be carefully considered, no, as among the range of options that the Philippines has in continuing its resupply of the BRP Sierra Madre.
Looking at videos now showing on our screens, quite violent activity there happening in the West Philippine Sea. The U.S. has yet to come to the defense of the Philippines despite the presence of the Mutual Defense Treaty, particularly because under Article 4 of the MDT, it says that the MDT can only be triggered by an armed attack. China has been skirting this through the use of water cannons, deliberately colliding with Philippine vessels. Is it actually time for Washington and Manila to consider updating the 1951 MDT to make it somehow more responsive to current realities on the ground?
Well, I think the updating of the MDT has already been taking place. That's why we had the bilateral guidelines issued last year. As to its interpretation, no, recently the U.S. Indo-PACOM came out with its interpretation that the MDT, considering armed attacks, no, is not necessarily limited to the use of weapons. In fact, it also considers the use of any kind of means which produces injury, death, or destruction. So it would include, I believe, even the use of water cannon in the way that it is being used by China. Now, the fact that it is covered by the MDT, however, is not the only answer you need here, because there are considerations of what would be the proportional and reasonable response to a water cannon attack. No? And that's something that is left to the Philippines and the United States, really, to discuss further.
Why do you think the Philippines is quite hesitant in operationalizing or in triggering the MDT mechanism right now, given that three Filipino soldiers were already injured just this weekend, and earlier this year, seven more others are around similar to that number, also injured with a similar attack from China?
Well, the Philippines is part of an international community that is heavily interdependent, no? And so any action that introduces like a major instability in the South China Sea not only will affect the Philippines and China, or even just the U.S., but the rest of the region as well. The idea that you can just start an armed conflict that easily, no, is something that goes back to probably the 19th century. Today in the modern world, no, you can't make those decisions easily, and you can't take these things very lightly. Besides, again, what we're thinking of here, what we consider here, is the issue of reasonability and proportionality. It is clear that China wants us to surrender on our own voluntarily through coercion, but using less than the use of armed force, no use of weapons and an armed attack. And the Philippines has to show, has to demonstrate that it is willing to withstand that, no, if it wants to ensure that its rights and entitlements in law are respected. No, at some point, China will have to give way to that, because without the support of the international community, without recognition of China's claims, in the end, it will only make more trouble for itself. No, it will have to interfere with the vessels of each and every country that enters the South China Sea, no, in order to enforce its claim. And that's why we are very important here. If we are the first to surrender, no, if we are the ones that recognize China's claims either expressly or impliedly through acquiescence, which is what they've been demanding, then that will actually be, you know, that's the first step down a slippery slope that will eventually see the international legal system really upended. And here in Southeast Asia, the South China Sea, it will basically start the decline of sovereignty independence on the part of all smaller Southeast Asian nations.
Right. Since you already mentioned the international legal system here, the Marcos administration has been mulling to file a fresh set of charges against China for environmental destruction in the West Philippine Sea. But with the current pace of things, do you think that the Marcos administration has enough time to file another case? Because as far as we're concerned, what we're seeing is somehow similar to what happened during the Aquino administration, in a sense that a case was filed against China at the midterm of the former president Benigno Aquino III, but then these cases did not really actually take time. They are not resolved in a year or two. Thereby, we might be pitted in a similar situation, in the sense whereby a case, the resolution of the case would be released after the current administration, which filed it, thereby risking another ordeal for the Philippines, similar to what Rodrigo Duterte did in 2016 by shelving an arbitration ruling in favor of the Philippines.
Well, yes, time is usually a consideration in filing cases like this, no, especially in the international tribunals. Now, number one, it stresses the importance of making sure that the Philippines' position on the West Philippine Sea and the South China Sea is consistent throughout administrations, and it should not matter what your political color is. You have to remember that we're talking about the heritage of the Filipino people here, regardless of who is on top. So that has to be clear. And that will now establish that continuity. The current administration does face that risk of time, no? But I think it also needs to be considered that, you know, when you make a move like that, when you initiate an international arbitration, usually that is also in coordination with another or other strategies on the political and diplomatic front, no? So it's not like you're betting all of your, putting all of your bets on just the legal case. You also have to be practical and sort of coordinate that legal case with your other diplomatic and political strategies. Now, I am sure that this is also being considered. No, I am aware that the Department of Justice has been quietly undertaking their case buildup. No. So when the decision is made to actually initiate a new proceeding, I think we can expect that it is not the only means by which the Philippines will be pursuing its case, its claims, and protecting its rights and entitlements against China's excessive claims.
Right. Professor Batumbacal, is there actually a way for the Philippines to safeguard or assure the consistency of its stance on the West Philippine Sea? Say, for example, a way to actually insulate it from changing political whims in administrations?
The way, I believe, really is with the Filipino people. Ultimately, all political leaders are answerable to their constituencies, no? And I think even during the Duterte administration, it was clear that the Philippine stance was in favor of stronger action, was in favor of protecting our rights and entitlements in the West Philippine Sea. And despite Duterte's effort, it just kept getting stronger. And I believe that that provided enough support to at least prevent, no, a totally complete and radical shift on in Philippine policy with respect to the West Philippine Sea, despite Duterte's antics and accommodations. So that is the only way. We have to continue to educate our people, to familiarize them with these issues, and stress the importance of standing up for our rights and entitlements in international law. Because if we don't do that, we will no longer be a sovereign nation a few years down the road.
Right. So it's quite easy to rally local support against China's aggressions in the West Philippine Sea. But what about internationally? We do know that President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. has been getting the support of countries like the United States, Japan, Australia, New Zealand. But similar efforts are not actually happening within the Southeast Asian region. How optimistic should the Philippines actually be that it would get the support it needs from its regional neighbors, considering that the host of the Association of Southeast Asian Nations Summit this year is Laos, a country which has one of the closest, if not the closest, ties with Beijing?
Yes, that is true. No, when it comes to the international community, of course, it will be a lot more complicated. Within ASEAN, there are, shall we say, divisions of opinion on this, especially because the relationship of each country to China are all different. No, and I think that will now have to be a factor in how the Philippines will pursue its diplomacy within the region. And the announcement last year of this idea of a new paradigm or new strategies, I think, goes along those lines. And you'll probably see this being implemented in the course of the next year or so. As for the rest of the world, no, then that one indeed needs quite a bit of work. I'm aware that the Foreign Affairs Department has been considering various ways and means of communicating to the rest of the international community, you know, our problems and our plights and the importance of this issue to them. It just really will have to take time because there are so many countries that we need to talk with, and so many different regions have different understandings and appreciations of Southeast Asia. But it has to be done. No? And I think that is the path forward for this administration for the rest of its term. It's really to now try to protect the Philippines' rights and entitlements by stressing to the rest of the world, no, that these rights and entitlements are what they had agreed to, what they had recognized through the United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea. And if one country, such as China, would be allowed to undermine the system, then the entire international community will eventually suffer because we will begin slipping back into the chaos of the seas prior to the emergence of these norms of United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea.
Attorney Batong Bakal, should the Philippines actually expect a more diluted ASEAN statement when it comes to the South China Sea issue, considering Laos chairmanship this year?
Well, definitely that is a very strong possibility. And that's because Laos is much more deeply indebted to China, I think, than most other countries. No? There's only one or two that I could think of that might be in the same situation. But for us, basically, we have to take it as a given. After all, we cannot control the rest of the region, and we do not have a say in how other countries in Southeast Asia conduct their foreign policy and their governments. No, we just have to take it as a given and then work around it.
Right.
ASEAN, after all, no, is not a monolithic organization. It is possible for fewer members of ASEAN to get together and face a common problem, where meaning that they don't have to involve everyone else in certain issues, and that has been demonstrated many times in several issues such as the Hays problem, the problem of piracy in two different areas, and in addressing things like oil pollution. It has shown that sub-ASEAN or what people call minilaterals, no, or sub-groupings basically of ASEAN are an option to pursue in addressing problems. And I think that that is something that the Philippines now is actually very actively considering.
Right. President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. has been trying to forge closer ties with Vietnam as well as Cambodia. And next month, he is set to travel to the United States for a trilateral meeting or a trilateral summit with Washington and Tokyo. What do you make out of that meeting? What do you expect to come out of that summit? And how effective will that actually be against China's expansionist agenda in the South China Sea?
Well, this is basically building and reinforcing a network of state have already expressed and demonstrated their commitment to international law, particularly UNCLOS. Japan and the United States are the prime examples of that. With respect to Cambodia, clearly it is like trying to feel out, no, or maybe trying to get a sense of where Cambodia lies, whether it will be a reliable partner or it will have to be considered sakel or neutral. No, these are all par for the course in the conduct of foreign relations. And I think what is happening now is that the Philippines has become much more proactive instead of being merely passive, no, in building up these networks for joint and cooperative action and essentially providing moral support, not just material support. And this is very important because it is part of the process of building a strong and resilient international community, a real one that relies on the rule of law and considers all of its members to be equal. This is something I think that is worth pursuing. And it, again, it will also take quite a lot of effort and a lot of time.
And we will have to leave it at that for now. Thank you so much for joining us this morning. And we hope to hear more from you once that summit starts next month. Thank you for joining us this morning, Professor J. Batong Bakal.
Welcome.